to get into the Word. We can visit afterwards. Good to see everybody. We're going to be back in John tonight. 2 weeks in a row, yay, in John, so that's exciting. Let's go ahead and get into just a quick review. If you've been with us in our study of John, this may be familiar. If not, let me just go through a couple of things. John is, technology. And again. Hang with us here. All of my notes just disappeared on me. So we're in John. We're going to be in John chapter 3 as soon as I can get over there. And we've been going through, I want to go through sort of a review session with you as soon as I can get my notes opened up. And we're going to be finishing up John, actually not quite finishing up John tonight. Here we go. Okay. So John's all about establishing this new worldview, right? John chapter 1 starts out with the idea of having life through the name of Jesus Christ. In fact, the whole theme of John is about that. That's why John wrote the book. If you later follow his conclusion towards the end of the book, he writes that that's what it's for. It's that we might believe on the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and that in believing we might have life through his name. And so John chapter 1 introduces this concept of having a gospel world view. It's where there's one true God. God's not a pluralism. God isn't something that we get to decide what he is. He's definitely not something of our own projection and making. He's also good, and he's inseparable from his word. And so we went over that in John chapter 1. His name is revealed in John chapter 1 as Jesus, as the Lord Jesus Christ. That same Jesus demonstrates at a wedding in John chapter 2 that you and I are intended upon to be used to bring glory to God through our life, through our existence. And that's really it. You think about all the things that we invest our time in, all the things that we do, whether it be in church here or just in your life or outside, just whatever you want to pick. As followers of Christ, though, we're to be ready. We're to be ready because the Lord's return is imminent. And with that in mind, we want to be sort of adjusting the trajectory of our life to participate, to do, to invest in things that bring glory to God's name. And because of that, we want to learn how to be obedient to the Holy Scripture. Chapter 3, we opened up a couple weeks ago introducing this character of Nicodemus. He was a leading Pharisee, and he was a leading legal and religious scholar, a ruler of the Jewish people. But he ends up coming to Jesus by night, and we looked at that. The reason was because he wasn't quite ready to confess who Jesus was publicly. And if we're all honest, sometimes we could agree with that, right? Sometimes we're not quite ready in our flesh. We're never really ready in our flesh to give Jesus his due, right? And that's why there has to be a transformation of who we are. There has to be a point in your life, a time in your life, where you've completely, as we just sang about, surrendered to Jesus Christ. Where your existence, you've agreed that I'm going to exchange everything about who I used to be for who Jesus wants me to be. And there's that exchange that takes place. We looked at Proverbs chapter 3, where it says in verse 5 and 6, that we trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding, and all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. So we have to then resist the idea that we can't know God. We have to resist, that's what Nicodemus struggled with. And we have to buy in to the concept that Jesus says that ye must be born again, both of water, that physical birth, that natural birth, and by spirit, the renewing of your spiritual identity, your soul, your spirit, and one day, according to the scripture, your body. Last week, we continued our story of Nicodemus. And I proposed to us that we need to be making sure that we're asking the right questions. Nicodemus approaches Christ in the dark of night. And we looked at two different types of questions. And we looked at the idea that your questions can tend towards faith. You and I can ask questions that tend towards faith. In other words, in awe of God, we can ask questions and pose, wow, how did God do that? Or what does God want out of me? But questions that tend towards you obeying the Lord. And then you can also ask questions, though, that tend toward fear and doubt. We looked at the default position of the fool in Proverbs 14, where the wisest man to ever live said that the fool hath said in his heart, there is no God. And so that is the default. That's the default for many people, right? And the reason it's foolish is because given everything, according to Romans chapter 1, you have to be deliberate. You have to be intentional and try not to believe in God's existence, right? You may not have to try to deny His power in your life, right, over sin or other things, the nasty flesh that we struggle with, but to doubt His very existence requires a special sort of rebellion. We looked at that last week. We talked about the idea of being diligent then about what we ought to know. Jesus called out Nicodemus. Jesus called him out and basically said, look, man, you should know these things. You are studied in the Word of God. You're a man over the people. You know all these things I'm talking to you about, yet you can't get it. And while you and I may not be Nicodemus in the Scripture, maybe we're not Nicodemus by heritage, but when God gives us the Word of God, we ought to be diligent to obey what we know. And so be diligent about what you ought to know already. And then finally, we looked at the love of God, how that it is free. And it provides the only way to eternal life and salvation from condemnation. But it can't be ignored, even though it's free and it does provide this great entrance into heaven, into a relationship with God. It can't be ignored. It's not something that just is projected upon you. It demands a reckoning according to the Scripture. We talked about this idea last week, how a gift for it to be complete requires both a giver and a receiver. I can't just bestow a gift upon several of you here and just decide I'm going to place it here, and if nobody comes and gets it, then it's not really a gift. It just ends up being wasted. Jesus closes the conversation with Nicodemus last time, just like a doctor would with this diagnosis and a prognosis. And it comes down to how He responds to light versus darkness. He identifies that the issue is that, but now how will we respond? You see, there's freedom and there's blessing in coming to the light, but there remains condemnation and loss if we stay in darkness. There's freedom and blessing in the light if we choose to remove ourselves through the power of the Holy Spirit in Christ from our old ways and step into the light to be exposed. There's freedom in that. It's liberating. But if we're to hunker down and just stay, you know, like a cockroach, you know, or something like that, or some disgusting rodent, and we try to hide out in the darkness, there's loss in that, the Bible says. There's condemnation. We remain in condemnation, according to John chapter 3. And so, I implored you last week, believer, we must stay in the light. If you've called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, then you've been brought into the light. Don't let your flesh hold sway over you to go back, to revert back. Stay where you belong. Stay in the light. Tonight, we're going to be finishing, or actually not finishing, I intended to, but I think there's going to be too much in this passage at the end of John chapter 3. We're going to be picking it up in John chapter 3, verse 22. And if you'll read along with me in John chapter 3, 22, It says this. We'll read down to verse 30. After these things, this conversation with Nicodemus, came Jesus and his disciples into the land of Judea, and there he tarried with them and baptized. And John also was baptizing in Enon near to Salem, because there was much water there, and they came and were baptized. For John was not yet cast into prison. Then there arose a question between some of John's disciples and the Jews about purifying. And they came unto John and said unto him, Rabbi, he that was with thee beyond Jordan, to whom thou bearest witness, behold, the same baptizeth, and all men come to him. John answered and said, A man can receive nothing except it be given him from heaven. Ye yourselves bear me witness that I said, I am not the Christ, but that I am sent before him. He that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. This my joy, therefore, is fulfilled. He must increase, but I must decrease. Bow with me as we go to the Lord in prayer and ask for help tonight. Father, we do ask for your help. Lord, we know that, God, you alone have the answer, Lord, to salvation, to eternal life, and God, to and you hold the place of preeminence. And Lord, so as we get into our passage tonight, I pray just for your help, God, for the preaching, for the audience, that you would open our hearts, open our minds, God, that we would be receptive to what your word says. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, so wouldn't you know it, as soon as I pray, there's an opportunity to trust God here. We've got another tech issue. Okay, bear with me. We're going to get into John chapter 3. If you want, you can go ahead and read it again, John chapter 3. I have no idea why it keeps canceling out and going back to my Outlook files. Okay, well, hang in there, guys. Here we go. Praise God. We've got notes back. Okay. We had printer issues at my house, and so otherwise I usually have a backup copy. I just run over there and grab a sheet, but not tonight. So John chapter 3, get back to the passage here in John chapter 3, verse 22. The title of the message tonight is Putting the Focus Back on Jesus. And that's what I want us to do is be able to engage and as church, but also as individual believers, and maybe for the first time in your life, learning how to put our focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. In verses 22 through 24, Jesus and his disciples, it says they're tarrying in Judea. And they're baptizing all those that came to them. And so I want you to get this down, that no matter where Jesus is at, no matter what he's doing the Father's work. And in these very first few verses, we see some insight into Jesus' way. Is that he's always at work doing the Father's business. It sort of gives us some foreshadowing to the passage in John chapter 5, verse 17, where it says, But Jesus answered them, My Father worketh hitherto, and I work. So he's always doing his Father's work. What a testimony that is for us. I know every one of us in here has things that could encompass our minds, that could distract us from doing God's work. But Christ exemplifies it. He does it again over in John chapter 6, or in Matthew chapter 6, right? Where he's telling us to seek God's kingdom first. He's going to take care of the rest of it. That's the message there. And so Jesus here, putting his money where his mouth is, right? Exemplifying it by his own actions, is doing the work of God, right? He leaves off this conversation with Nicodemus, jumps right into Judea, the greater region there, and he starts baptizing people, he and his disciples. John the Baptist, he's on the other side of Jordan, the passage indicates. He's also baptizing across the river. And what you'll see here is we just read in the passage that a dispute ensued. Did you catch that in the passage? That sort of this confrontation between the Jews, presumably the leaders of the Jewish people, possibly even Nicodemus, who just came out of this conversation about being born of water and being born again. And it's very likely that he's following around Jesus, right? He just had this sort of super sneaky encounter, and maybe he's just taking some more notes here. Verse 25 through 26, on the heels of this encounter, we have both Jesus Christ baptizing on one side of the river and John on the other side of the river. A question arises in John the Baptist's camp. And his followers, who they know that John is a faithful man, they notice that Jesus is also baptizing men, which was a mark of preparing oneself for the coming Messiah. And John's followers, they begin to notice, you know, like, hey, this guy is starting to draw bigger crowds than we are, JB, you know, because I'm sure that's what they called him. I think they dropped the T, you know, JTB, but JB. Hey, this guy's drawing bigger crowds than we are. And the text seems to simply imply that John's followers were a minimum, they were beginning to question, right, the efficacy of what Jesus was doing. This guy's baptizing also. Is that real? If not, challenging it. And not unlike the leaders that we'd looked at before several weeks back, that these liberated Jews had probably been underneath beforehand. Well, they may have reverted a little bit. They may have taken on some of their own jealousy of Jesus from John that we've discussed before, with that jealousy of the Jewish leaders over the people. Perhaps, you know, we just give them the benefit of the doubt. I don't know. Maybe they just were trying to make sure that authentic ministry was taking place. They were protecting the authenticity of what God had called them to do. But I kind of doubt that, and here's why I doubt that. Because they admit, even in their own question, did you see that? That Jesus was the one that John had bore witness of. Remember how John did that back in John chapter 1? You could turn a couple pages if you have your Bible open. John chapter 1, verse 15 through 18. John is talking to his followers, and John bare witness of him in John chapter 1, 15, and cried, saying, This was he of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. He's bearing witness. And of his fullness have all we received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, right? That's how we used to do it. But grace and truth came by Jesus Christ, as he's bearing witness of this man. No man cometh or hath seen God at any time. The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. And he's bearing witness, this great event right there on the riverside, right? He's being baptized. He's bearing witness to his disciples, John's disciples. So John's disciples know this. They even bring it up in context. Hey, remember that guy you said basically was the Son of God? Well, he's baptizing too. What do you have to say about that? It's like they just couldn't quite get it. They knew. They knew what they were told about him. But, man, if we're honest, I think they're being just like you and I can be sometimes, right? Where we know, we can know. I mean, we've seen this before. The Bible, if you'll recall, I've brought this passage up a couple times in our study in James chapter 2, James chapter 2, verse 19. Listen to what the Bible says about even the devils, right? The demons. In James chapter 2, 19, thou believest that there is one God, thou doest well. It's like James has given them a pat on the head here. Hey, the devils also believe and tremble. That's what he ends that passage with. So I want you to get this down tonight as we get into the passage. And it's a short passage, but I think it's exactly what God would have us to see. Did you know, I'm going to ask you a question. Did you know that there are two different types of belief? There are two different types of belief. You see, in the wake of 9/11, if some of you remember, it's been, I can't believe it's been 20 years almost. It's amazing. I remember exactly where I was, which ages me, I know, but it was a momentous time in our country's history and transformed a lot about who we are and some of our freedoms even, and how we approach certain things. But in the wake of that, in the immediate after moments of 9/11, I mean, I'm talking the days, weeks, and months after, government agencies began to scramble to work together, sometimes for the first time ever in their existence. And they began to piece together components of the data, right? And it became clearer and clearer what the picture was, right? I mean, we had all of the data. All of the data was there. We could have pieced together the puzzle. I'm not saying that we could have prevented it, but a lot of people suspect that maybe we could have. The information was there. The CIA had pieces linking bin Laden to a certain group. The NSA had other bits of pieces that they'd collected based on phone call interception. I mean, even the FBI had been, they had certain men of the 19 who had conspired to run the airplanes into the building, into the Pentagon, into Pennsylvania, into that field, which had another target. I don't know that we'll ever know that, what that target was, but all of the data comes out and we start to see that, oh, well, this guy knew this and we had this and the information wasn't shared, but it was all there. All of the information was there. We had all of the data. Probably something could have been done, right? But our belief, I don't think anybody questioned the efficacy of the information, the factual nature of it, but our belief led us to do nothing but just sit on the data. We just sat on the information. So get this down, and I apologize, I don't have handouts. Again, my printer really did a number on us this week, but get this down. Point number one is this. There are two types of belief. There are two types of belief. The difference is between receiving belief and rejecting belief. Receiving belief and rejecting belief. Receiving belief works in your life and leads to a change. And that comes from you learning how to obey the Word of God. Rejecting belief leads to a stagnation, meaning you're doing nothing with the information. And that comes from you disobeying the information, disobeying the Word of God in your life. I'll say that again. There's a difference between receiving belief and rejecting belief. Receiving belief works in your life and leads to a change. That's where you learn how to obey the Word of God. Rejecting belief leads to stagnation, and that's disobedience of the Word of God. In other words, you've been confronted with what the Bible says about you. Some of you have been confronted with just a lot of stuff. You've maybe grown up in the church even, so you know, and you know you're going to answer for that one day. Others of you, for the first time in your life, you're being exposed to what the Holy Book says for yourself. Praise God. Now you're going to be accountable to that. That's a big, big obligation. You can either receive it into your life and let it change you, or you can know it and reject it. You can even believe it and reject it. That's the type of belief that the devils have. You guys follow me on this? This is kind of a scary thought that we can know, even believe information, but I'm just going to keep it over there. It's good for other people. I know it's true even, but I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to adhere to it. That's dangerous if we find ourselves face to face with that. The disciples of John, they knew. You guys see that in the passage? He had already informed them of who Jesus Christ was. They just weren't ready quite yet to give him his just desserts. They weren't ready to receive him for who he was. It was still, John, what do you think about that guy? Remember you talked about that guy? Their belief had not yet compelled them to change. Or as the Bible would call it, to repent. Well, thank God, John was not full of himself. He was true to his own calling. And he begins to set the record straight for us in John chapter 3, verse 27 through 30. He uses this illustration about marriage, in fact, to explain who Jesus is compared to himself. John, the man who Christ would report at one point to be the greatest of those born of women, begins to humbly characterize himself as a friend of the bridegroom, and pointing to the fact, just like he did in John chapter 1, hey, it's that guy. It's him, Jesus, as the bridegroom. We see this throughout Scripture where Christ is identified in this role. And so I just want to take a couple of minutes here and show you what the Bible says about Jesus Christ being the bridegroom to his bride, the church, you and I. We looked at a wedding a few weeks back in John chapter 2, and it's a special time, a wedding is. I want you to see, though, how Christ is depicted. And young men, young ladies, if you're joining us online, if that fits you, if you're here, pay attention to this. You need to look at these characteristics. These are on display with regards to what a healthy marriage looks like, with what a healthy mate would look like. Ephesians chapter 5, let me lay this out for you in a few passages. The first one will be in Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 through 27. Listen, if you haven't turned there, or if you have a second, turn over to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25 through 27. The apostle says, "Husbands, love your wives." So ladies, that's one thing you need to be looking for. Somebody who loves you. And how? I'm not talking the mushy-gushy, you know, yeah, I love you because you're hot love. Love as Christ, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. You know how he gave himself for it, right? Men, young ladies. He went all the way to the cross. He surrendered his own desires of the flesh. He gave up everything for the betterment of his bride. The Bible says that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word. Man, is your husband or your would-be husband, are they investing the word of God in you? Are they living the word of God for you? The Bible says that he might present it to himself, a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Ladies, men, if your girlfriend, boyfriend is leading you to be spotted, blemished, wrinkled, unholy, they're not doing you right. They're not doing you right. They're not honoring you truly. And that's going to come to bear at some point. It will be revealed, and you're going to know that for bad one day. So make sure you're trusting God with those relationships. But to our point, Christ loved the church because Christ is the bridegroom. He's the main thing. Look over another passage, Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, verses 7 through 9. Revelation 19, 7 through 9. "Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb," capital L, we know who that is. We've looked at that in John chapter 1 before. "The marriage of the Lamb," Jesus Christ, "is come, and his wife hath made herself ready, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness of saints. And he saith unto me," okay, so you see, that's us there. Again, the church, the saints, he's talking about us. We are the bride. "And he saith unto me, Write, blessed are they which are called unto the marriage supper of the Lamb. And he saith unto me, These are the true sayings of God." 2 Corinthians chapter 11. 2 Corinthians chapter 11. And I wish we had more time. Maybe someday we'll go into a dating and marriage relationships class on a Wednesday night. But 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 1 through 4. "Would to God ye could bear with me a little in my folly, and indeed bear with me. Jealous over you with godly jealousy," Paul says. "For," why? "Because, for I have espoused you to one husband," church. "You've been betrothed," he says. You're engaged. It is my job to make sure I present you, he says, "as a chaste virgin to Christ. But I fear," verse 3, "lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your minds should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. For if he that cometh preacheth another Jesus, whom we have not preached, or if ye receive another spirit which ye have not received, or another gospel which ye have not accepted, ye might well bear with him." Paul says, look, You're betrothed to Jesus Christ, church, and I'm here to make sure that you stay clean, that your doctrine in particular stays clean, that you don't go out and believe something else about yourself. Believe that Jesus was not sufficient. Accept some other works-based doctrine where you have to earn your way into credibility or into righteousness or into eternal life. Jesus paid it all. And Paul says, don't let anybody mess that up for you. Don't let anybody get you twisted like the serpent tried to do with Eve and beguiling her. So John sets the record straight. Back in John chapter 3, we find out that Jesus is it. He's not only the real deal, but he's the main deal. He's in fact the only deal if we're paying attention. Yesterday, I had the privilege to hold a funeral service, and it was of a family member of mine, my grandmother by marriage. And I've done several funerals. I can't remember how many funerals I've done in my life, and many, many weddings. And I was just thinking about sort of what goes on at a funeral or at a wedding in particular. And if you've ever been part of a wedding, you know that a wedding can be a madhouse, right? I mean, not only the day of the wedding, but in the weeks and the months leading up to a wedding. I mean, just utter chaos, right? I'm catching eyes with some of the mothers in the room here. And it can just be maddening what goes on at a wedding. Maybe you've been part of a wedding before. And, you know, a wedding is supposed to be about the bride, right? And the groom, the bride and the bridegroom. But you occasionally have those weddings where you've got the maid of honor or the best man who either by intention or by ignorance and stupidity just steals the show and makes it just all about them, right? Or maybe you've had that momzilla that just wants her way, right? The cake has to be this way, or we've got to have this hall that we rent out. It can't be this place, and it's got to be at this church, and the dress has to look like this, and oh, that's the hem is too long, or this, or I'm getting in over my head now in these details. I don't know really about these things because, guys, we don't care as much, right? But John says, look, the bridegroom is the focus of the wedding, and thus by implication, the bride, right? The party, the wedding party, that is where it's at. So get this down. Here's point number two tonight. There is none greater than Jesus. There's none greater than Jesus. That's point number two. That fact should compel us to favor him above all things. Above all of our victories, above all of our sorrows, above, I mean, everything. John puts it, if you look back at verse 29, he puts it this way, he that hath the bride is the bridegroom, but the friend of the bridegroom, which standeth and heareth him, rejoiceth greatly because of the bridegroom's voice. That's powerful. But you see what he's saying here? It's his voice. So I want you to check yourself. Consider what your approach is to the bridegroom's voice. You follow me? Like, when you're confronted by what the Word of God says to you, whether for good or whether for change, whether it affirms what you're doing, praise God for those times when we know we're just in tune with God and we're in obedience and we're, man, thank you, Lord. And you know what? As a believer, let me just give you some confidence that in Christ, you are always affirmed, first off. But you know what? As a believer, sometimes there are moments where even though our eternal salvation is affirmed, even though our identity in Jesus Christ is affirmed because of what he did, not because we're all that, okay? Nobody's suggesting that. But as believers, there's moments, though, when we're looking through the Word of God, and it'll say something like, and that's not becoming a child of God. You know, I'm ad-libbing here. When we're confronted by something in the Scripture that, oh, well, that doesn't look like me. Right? Well, your eternal soul is affirmed. Your identity is affirmed. You are part of the body of Christ. Praise God. We need you. to accomplish the work of God. But you know what? Sometimes when we're faced with that, you know what it means we've got to do? We've got to confront ourselves and decide, are we going to rejoice? Am I going to believe what God says about me is good, even if it doesn't line up right now? Or am I going to reject it? Am I going to receive it, like we just talked about? Or am I going to reject it? Right? So the friend, if you're a friend of Jesus, whether you're confronted by something that doesn't line up or not, you're going to rejoice. Man, thank you, God, for pointing out that I had a giant booger on my face. Because I'm going to go now and clean that off. I'm not going to be out in public and facing the world with a distorted face, or my hair's messed up, or I forgot to zip up my zipper, or something like that. Thank you, Jesus, for pointing out something about me and my character. As painful as that is, I rejoice in that, because I'm walking, I'm beginning, and I'm learning how to walk closer with God. Amen? Now compare that, right? Because I'm telling you, in your flesh, that's not going to be the default. That's only going to come if you predetermine ahead of time that you're going to be a friend of Jesus, that you truly want to identify with Him on His side, right? Compare that, though, to Genesis chapter 3. In Genesis chapter 3, look back there, and this is the story, if you don't recall, Genesis chapter 3, this famous story of the temptation of Adam and Eve in the garden. And turn over to Genesis chapter 3. I'm going to particularly ask you to read verses 8 through 11. But the serpent comes in verses 1 through 7, and he begins talking to the woman, and he begins to tempt her with what the Word of God said. What did God actually tell her? And in verse 4 he says, "And the serpent said unto the woman, You shall not surely die, for God doth know in the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil." And so you see she goes ahead and they end up actually eating it, and she gives it to her husband, and he eats it as well. And verse 7, "And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons." And look at verse 8 now in Genesis chapter 3. Look what happens. "And they heard the voice of the Lord." They heard the voice of the Lord God, comparing to John chapter 3, where the friend of the bridegroom rejoiceth. I mean, picture yourself like at a baseball game or a football game or whatever your flavor is, or a concert, and you're just rejoicing in adulation. You're cheering on your team or the music, the feeling. It's a moment of rejoicing. Compare that to Genesis 3:8, "And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden. And the Lord God called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said," again, you got to underline this and compare it to John chapter 3, "I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid." Man, you see, God wants us to rejoice. It continue on, verse 11, he said, "Who told thee that thou wast naked?" It's the antithesis of what God's trying to draw in the relationship that he wants with all of us. He wants to affirm you in his Son, Jesus Christ. He wants to clothe you and know that you are clothed in his righteousness. He wants you to be confident in that relationship and that walk with him. He doesn't want you to be abhorrent of yourself, to be fearful of him, to hide from him. You see what sin does? You see what sin does when we don't receive Christ in faith? When instead we end up knowing what Christ said, but we want to reject his power in our life and let him, and I know it to be true, but I just can't put this down. I can't give into this thing. That's the devil saying, "Hey, you're naked. You're always going to be naked. Just give up. This isn't going to work for you. You can't fix yourself." Now that last part's true, because you can't. I can't. But Jesus Christ can. and he's called us to have faith in him. So as we close, I'm going to go ahead and ask our praise team to come forward to dismiss us. And as we do, let me just ask you, where are you at with all of this? Where are you at with all of this? When you hear God's voice, are you recoiling in fear? Right? When you hear God's voice, does that make you want to recoil and hide and to run away? Does the thought of being with believers make you want to hide? When you hear the word of God, do you want to shun him? Do you want to just plug your ears and block it out so you don't have to deal with it? We talked about this last week. Nicodemus was called out that in his natural state, his heart remained dark. And he did not want to be exposed to the light. That was his issue. But what kind of life is that? You know what kind of life that is? It's the Genesis 3 life. It's the Genesis 3 life where you and I, and if you're joining online, it's where we are stuck in that mode of believing and thinking. We're naked. That we are unjustified before the Father because we've refused, we've rejected the truth that we know to be true. I know the problem. I know the problem. I know it in my life. I know it in your life. The Bible's clear about this. What happens is that someone, just like all the way back in Genesis chapter 3, the pattern continues all throughout all 66 books of the Bible. Somebody does this. Yo, psst. Hey, you're not good enough. You're naked. And just like in the Garden of Eden, you temporarily forget what God has said about you. That he loves you unconditionally and has called you into a new purpose, one that's fulfilling, one that's empowering and liberating from a life of sin and shame, one where your existence is no longer focused on you, but on being a conduit that is able to bring glory to the Father forever. You see, the devil wants you to think that you're on the wrong side with Christ. That's what he wants you to think. Right? That is his attack, is to make us believe that there's something wrong with the gospel. He wants you to wallow in shame. Shame over your sin, whether past sin or present sin or sin that we will commit in the future. Even shame over Christ, the Bible says. Listen, we are wise to count the cost. But if we're willing to take a step of faith, God promises he'll do the rest. It's all it requires is to simply obey in the smallest. Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, 29, and 30 says this. Jesus is speaking and he says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. Learn how I live, following the Father, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and ye shall find rest in your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." And that's the paradox, my friends. Your flesh cannot receive that. Your flesh will reject that notion. Your flesh will lead you to conclude and to believe, no, it can't be that easy that I just believe and receive what Jesus Christ did for me. I've got to do something myself. And until I get that fixed, I'm not going to be worthy. Man, do not let pride overtake you in that thought. Reject it. Turn from that and just simply receive in belief what Jesus Christ says about us. It's why Paul says in 1 Corinthians 15, "And why stand ye in jeopardy every hour?" Talking about the cares of the church. "I protest by your rejoicing." He uses that same word Christ did, or John did. "Which I have in Christ our Jesus our Lord, I die daily." That was his rejoicing. He dies daily. And so we're going to close with this. John chapter 3, verse 30. As Paul dies daily, look at what John the Baptist says. "He must increase, but I must decrease." And friends, that's the formula to a fulfilled life in Christ. Are you ready for that? Do you want that? So we have a decision to be made today. Are you going to have the type of belief that receives the truth? Or are you going to just let it sit idle, acknowledge it, it's true, but not let it change your life? Right? That's the first question. And then are you letting anything be greater than Jesus in your life? Are you letting anything be greater than Jesus? Has pride overcome you that you somehow think that, man, Jesus is the greatest, but I still have to work my way to goodness with God? I've got to earn His trust. No, like we talked about, there are going to be moments when you're confronted with the truth of Scripture. And yeah, it's going to require transformation. But that's transformation in trust. As you trust God in faith that He's going to handle it if you simply obey. Are we willing to do that? Let's bow our head, and I'm going to turn it over to the praise team. If you've got a decision to be made today, I'm just going to ask you, after we conclude, come down, talk to me. I'll be in the front for a few minutes. If you're online and God has spoken to you out of His Word this evening, please message us. We'd love to pray with you. You can also phone the church. Nobody's going to pick it up right now, but as soon as we can, we'll call you back. I love you all. I'm going to pray now over the end of our service and that God would move in us with His Word. Father, thank You for just speaking Your Word to us tonight out of John chapter 3. Lord, we want to have the faith that receives You, not just acknowledging academically that You're true, but God, receiving it, that we might be changed by it, that we might be obedient to Your Word. Lord, would You help us do that? God, help us to get accountable. Lord, help us to get into discipleship. Lord, to get into a small group. God, to be around brothers and sisters on a regular basis that we might be challenged. And Lord, help us to see that You are the greatest, that there's none greater than You. And God, because of that, You deserve that I die daily, that I would decrease so that You can increase in my life. That just like at the wedding we talked about in John chapter 2, that You would be able to use me, that You'd be able to use the members of our church, God, to bring glory to Your life, that it might be manifest in us. Lord, if there's anybody here who needs to make a decision, Lord, to commit themselves unto You for sanctification, for consecration, God, Lord, to be saved, Lord, give them the courage to have faith today. In Jesus' name, amen.
You guys can stand or sit, whatever you need to do.